This episode is powered by denmeditation.com. Though meditation is the primary focus, the bigger goal is for people to understand and love themselves, thus creating more harmony in the community at large. To find out more about Den Meditation's teacher training programs, retreats, and all things Den Meditation, go to denmeditation.com. Den Talks podcast. This is Tal, your host and the founder of Den Meditation. Well, we have story time today, and I kind of love it. We have Debbie Solaris on. She is an ET contactee, an interdimensional traveler, and a galactic historian. So what I wanted her to do, because I feel like we have so many people on who sometimes have these incredible downloads and connections that kind of explain our history and where we come from, but it's confusing if you don't really already know it. So Debbie is so kind and so patient and so lovely that she kind of walks us through this gigantic galactic history, you know, where the dark and the light comes from, you know, the intentions, the different galaxies, and bringing us all the way back to now and how we are here on Earth. And what's so beautiful about it is, A, it's nice to understand that. But as we said, you realize a little bit of what kind of the struggle is still happening on Earth today, which we get into a little bit as well. But again, it's story time. A good beginning chunk is sit back and just listen as she walks us through what crazy stories are made of. Nobody could make it up. It's that insane. So thank you so much. Let us know what you think. Drop us a line and please subscribe. So talk to me. I want to kind of do, you know, on this podcast, we have a lot of channelers. We've talked a lot about kind of the woo-woo, the aliens, the intergalactic. Mm-hmm. But what I really think is so amazing about what you do too is you really lay out kind of the history really well. Mm-hmm. And so one of the areas I want to talk to you about, and then I want to get into your personal stuff as well, because I find it fascinating how you got here.
Yeah.
But I would love for you, because I think especially since the pandemic and all the way through what's going on now, you hear a lot about the dark versus light and the dark forces. And then, you know, reptilians come into that. And I think people kind of always hear it, you know, mm-hmm. out and about. If you could give a little bit and just talk about it, tell the story, tell what you've learned through the Akashic Records and through all of your connections mm-hmm. of really, what are the reptilians? Are they really bad? Is it bad? Is it good? What does it mean? And how does it relate to us? And feel free, don't worry about it, that you might be chatting for a while. Like, tell us a story.
I can tell stories. It's great to be here. Thank you for having me, Tal. It's great
I'm
to
so
be
happy.
Here. Yeah. And I guess, you know, if I had to start the story, you know, it started millions and millions of years ago in, you know, when this, you know, galaxy was formulated, you know, so this galaxy was specifically formulated to be the backdrop of this experimentation that source energy wanted to go through where it was splitting itself off. So I'm going to, you know, just give a little bit of a background.
Great.
And then we'll move into present day. So my understanding is that initially, things were supposed to happen in this universe. So we live in this multi-universe reality where when it's our universe's turn, you know, to go through this, you know, separation from source, you know, everything gets kind of expanded out, you know. So Andromeda Galaxy was originally supposed to be the location for this. And Andromeda Galaxy mm-hmm. is not the same as Andromeda Constellation. A lot of people get those two areas confused. The reason why it's called Andromeda Galaxy is because from our vantage point here on Earth, we see it in the Andromeda constellation, but it's further out. It was a very high vibrational, you know, galaxy. And the co-creator beings, you know, they have etheric beings that live in this reality, felt that it wasn't really appropriate to use as a, you know, backdrop for physical life. So they created another galaxy, which was a smaller galaxy that they can use for this purpose. And so this is where the separation of the Milky Way came from the Andromeda Galaxy. And because there needed to be a connection between the two, there was a stargate or star portal called Antares that was created to be this connection. So these beings, because they were invested in this project, you know, if you want to call it that, I know that sounds kind of minimal for, you know, what was going on, you know, this big creation process. They made a commitment, you know, that they were going to be a part of this whole process. So they came in through the Antares Stargate into the Milky Way and started creating things here. So initially, because Antares is a star that's actually located in the Scorpio constellation. So it's a real star. It's in a real constellation. And there were gatekeepers that were allowing people to come in beings to come in, but not necessarily leave. So once you committed to this project, you were committed for, you know, for a while. So these beings started establishing galactic councils in what is now known as Galactic Center, which is between the constellations of Scorpio and Sagittarius. I think its exact location is 28 degrees Sagittarius. So from there, they started creating physical planets and realities. And the location they chose was Lyra constellation. Even when you look at Lyra in the star map, it looks very insignificant. Like, you know, it's just a little kite looking. It's supposed to represent the lyre, but it looks like a little kite to me. And the reason why they chose that constellation is because it has the conditions most conducive for, for physical life. You know, it has very inhabitable planets. And this is true even today. You know, if you go on cosmos.com or nasa.com and you look at, you know, articles about potential inhabitable planets, you know, or exoplanets, you will see quite a few of them in the Lyra constellation, even today, including, you know, some in Alpha Centauri or something like that. But what happened was that they started creating physical life there. And, you know, these beings had been around for thousands of years, even before they encountered the reptilians. Now, to give you a little backdrop on the reptilians and who they are, the reptilian beings were from a different consciousness. You know, they didn't even originate from this particular galaxy or universe. They actually came originally from a different universe. And a lot of people don't know that. And this is just information I've downloaded from the records. You know, it's like sometimes you go into records and it's like, wow, where did this come from? You know, it's like you get some really crazy information. And what I saw in the records about the reptilians is in this other universe, they got into a war with some avian beings. So this is like this whole, other story here. And the avian beings, I think, just got fed up and pretty much kicked them out of that universe. And they deposited them in this universe, in our galaxy, in the constellation of Draco. Okay, so these beings were pretty much pissed off at this point, you know, because they had abundant planets in their old universe. Then they go to Draco and Draco doesn't have any resources, you know, so they're looking for resources. They're looking for places they can conquer, you know, and Lyra was located right next door. So unfortunately, you know, when Lyra was created, it was created next door to Draco. And this is just my theory, but I think that was very purposeful. I think they wanted to see how the light and the dark was going to interact with each other. Because a lot of people ask, you know, well, why would they put Lyra right next to Draco? And I think it was part of the experiment. You know, I think it was part, see what would happen. So Draco decided to reach out to the Lyran people. So Lyra had beautiful paradise planets. They had two human races. So one was the white Caucasian looking Lyran race that a lot of people associate with Lyra, but they also had a blue skinned Vegan race that inhabited the planets that revolved around Vega. And the Vega people were representations of mother goddess consciousness. So Source always has a template. So the template is mother goddess consciousness and father god consciousness. That's the basic Source template. And so everything in our universe follows this template. So I think the Vegans were created first because they are mother goddess consciousness, and Andromeda Galaxy is a mother goddess consciousness reality. Then the White Larians were created, and they had different qualities, you know. So because the Vegans were more mother goddess consciousness, they were more inwardly focused, more spirituality focused. You know, they had more interest in healing, whereas the Larians were more interested in physical expression. You know, so these were people that were agricultural, that were athletic. You know, they were, you know, very physical people. They valued the qualities of really good hard work. And these people lived very simple lives, you know, so they didn't have initially all the technology and all the stuff, you know, that came later in their history. But around the time when the Draconians started to get interested in Lyra, so they were looking at it like, you know, those planets have a lot of resources. They had, you know, beautiful paradise planets.
And with the Vegans and the Lyrans, or however you say it, would they blend?
They didn't initially. I think there was some interactions, you know, because in the records I see some of my clients might have been Lyran, but they had a, you know, they might have gone to Vega for some reason and they fell in love with somebody in Vega. Mm-hmm. You know, so sometimes that kind of stuff happens. But for the most part, they were pretty much separate. The blending didn't happen until these races left Lyra and ended up in other star systems, you know. So they basically were just developing their civilizations. And like I said, it was amazing. You know, it was like Avatar, you know, if you want to compare it to something that we know from pop culture. So these beings, you know, were pretty much, you know, living beautiful paradise lives. They didn't have to deal with much adversity. So when the reptilians reached out to them, you know, reptilians are deceptive. Okay. I mean, that's one of their qualities. You know, they know how to deceive. And I can get into this whole story of how I think it's, you know, the Adam and Eve story is an analogy of what happened in Lyra, but, you know, we won't go down that path, but I do think it's an analogy. But basically what they told the Lyrians was like, hey, we want to create a trade system. You know, we noticed your planets have a lot of resources. We have really great technology. Maybe we can, you know, share our technology for your resources. And so, you know, I think initially the Lyrians were, you know, a little bit, you know, cautious, but then they were like, you know what, we really can use some technology. You know, we could really use some upgraded technology. Because around this time, they were starting to create starships and things like that, but they knew that their technology wasn't that advanced compared to the reptilian. It was a deal that they couldn't pass down, or so they thought. But unfortunately, the whole purpose of that was so the reptilians can go on their planets and see where their weak areas were so they can ambush them and conquer them. And Lissa Royale Holt does a beautiful job of describing the whole story in her book, The Prism of Lyra, which is an amazing little book. I mean, it's not a very thick book, but I think she really compiles the story quite well. And according to her, and according to what I saw in the records, there was millions and millions of Lyrans who lost their lives during those wars. Because they weren't prepared, you know.
To most people in an incarnation now, like when you read their records, are most people connected to a star family somewhere, or, you know, some lineage of, you know, whether it be Lyran or Vegan or reptilian or from Orion or Sirius or the Pleiades? Like, do most of us come from one of those?
Oh yeah. Very rarely do I get like a younger soul, you know, as far as my Akashic clients that have never had incarnations other than Earth. I mean, there's a few of them out there. I would, you know, at least the ones that would approach me. But for the most part, I would say right now in this time and period on planet Earth, this is the time where we're seeing the most star seeds and the most, you know, souls, you know, ancient souls that came from other realities currently having incarnations in our planet. So the reason why this story is important, you know, because some people say, well, that happened millions of years ago. How does that affect us? You know, it's not, doesn't have anything to do with Earth. It has a lot to do with Earth. because a lot of us are still living out the lessons that we are dealing with.
Well, that's why I was asking the question, because I keep thinking, I mean, so many of us have, you know, history in this incarnation attached to lineage of war and trauma. I mean, a lot of us, especially like if you're connected at all to what's going on in the Middle East now, or you, I mean, it doesn't matter. There's, you know, that in your lineage, there's probably been a lot of trauma. So it's interesting to see that it's even beyond that.
Oh, it's beyond it.
I mean, because what you're about to, the part of the story you're in is very traumatic.
It's traumatic. I mean,
these were like a peaceful people who didn't even understand.
They didn't even
what
understand
war was.
What was happening. Yeah, they didn't even know what was happening. I mean, Alarans are resourceful people. Don't get me wrong; they weren't stupid. You know, a lot of people thought, you know, well, they must be really stupid to allow the reptilians to take over then. And I said, no, they weren't stupid people. They just, you know, I think never experienced adversity or violence, you know, so.
It wasn't in their universe. The manipulation didn't exist. Like, that just wasn't part of their vocabulary. And violence or, like I think you were saying before, I mean, there wouldn't even be a weapon anywhere around them to use to defend themselves. It just wasn't part of their society.
Defenseless. I think the Vagans, you know, from what I saw in the records, they were a little bit more advanced because they were created, you know, earlier. So they did have some weaponry in their starships, you know, so they fared better during the wars. But the Laren people didn't even have weapons on their ships. You know, I mean, they just basically had to escape, you know, I mean, and quite a few of them did escape, you know, and they dispersed out into the galaxy. But I think Lissa Royale Holt says, released her guidance, told her that they say 50 million Larens lost their lives. I mean, that is like shocking. You know, that's the most catastrophic event that's, I think, ever happened in our universe. And so these Larens were basically just hightailing it out of their planets because they couldn't defend themselves. They ended up, I think, residing. I mean, they had to hide out because the reptilians were after them. You know, it wasn't like, oh, yeah, they left and that was it. I mean, they were constantly in danger. They had to hide out in some of the way stations, what I call way stations, Cygnus, and which is, yeah.
Why were the reptilians after them specifically? So when the Larens left, basically all the resources, which is what they wanted, basically like, here, have it, we're out. Mm-hmm. Why were they still going after the specific race?
No, that's a good question. I think probably because they're just spiteful beings. You know? I don't know. I mean, part of maybe the concern was maybe they were going to leave and come back and try to take their planets back also, you know, so there was that maybe thought process, you know, so. So these beings were scoping out areas that were as far away from Draco as possible. So the Pleiades is 500 light years away. You know, I mean, they had to travel for years to get to these systems, even in their starships. I think Sirius was another, Sirius is fairly close to Earth. It's, you know, light years away. So it's one of the closest systems, but. And then there's Andromeda constellation, which is 2,000 light years away. I mean, that's really far, you know. So these people, they were resourceful and they were survivors. And, you know, they had to create technologies where they had to, you know, they were constantly looking for water, and the reptilians knew this. So they learned how to extract water from asteroids. I mean, I think that's freaking amazing. Yeah, I mean, they were growing plants and food on board their starships. You know, it was just these people were resourceful. So a lot of them ended up colonizing other star systems. So that's why we see this disbursement, you know, of humanity or humanoid beings throughout multiple star systems in our galaxy. So the story continues on where quite a few of the reptilian beings are also escaping the wars. You know, some of them were just like, you know what, we don't want any part of this. You know, some of them ended up residing in Sirius. So Sirius is one of the most diverse star systems, not as diverse as Orion, which is really diverse. If you ever watch the Star Wars series, I always compare Star Wars to Orion because I think it's the story of the Orion Wars. But so how this relates to Earth and our situation right now with reptilians is that quite a few of these human beings, you know, or these humanoid refugees ended up in Orion. And Orion was a big melting pot. You know, I always call Orion like the melting pot of the galaxy because pretty much everything ended up in Orion, you know, so everything ended up there. You know, mostly the humans and the human-like beings ended up in the belt stars. So I call the belt stars of Orion the good zone. You know, that was the zone that wanted just peace and unity, just to be left alone. The outlier stars in Orion were the reptilian outposts, the gray alien outposts. A lot of people don't realize this, but Zeta Reticuli is a close neighbor of Orion. I mean, it's just right next door. So there's quite a few gray, tall grays and small grays that also resided in Orion.
And those are known as being not the friendliest.
Yeah,
correct?
They were not basically benevolent, you know, so you have this whole empire versus the resistance, you know, story going on in Orion. So that's where Star Wars kind of mimics the Orion Wars, which I actually think maybe George Lucas got a download from a past life or something.
I mean, so many of these, you know, stories, books, movies, they must.
They're based on real events, you know. I don't think, you know, it's just somebody's imagination, although maybe there's some imagination involved, but I think a lot of these sci-fi movies have basis in reality, you know, so.
Totally.
Yeah. So then there was constant wars because you had, you know, the belt star people that just wanted, you know, to be left alone. You know, they just wanted their peace. But they had to fight back, you know. So these are, like I said, they're resourceful people. So there was they developed what it was called, known as the Black League Resistance Fighters. So they were fighting for their freedom, you know. They didn't want to become part of the human trafficking that was occurring with the Empire. So all the outlier stars, so that would be Betelgeuse, Bellatrix, and Grygol, were all reptilian, you know, gray alien insectoid being outposts. And so there was these constant wars, went on for millions of years. So eventually the Galactic Federation got involved because the belt star people asked for assistance from the Galactic Federation. So the Galactic Federation basically is all the benevolent races, and there's, you know, thousands and thousands of races of beings that are part. A lot of people associate it with the Pleiadians, but it's more than just the Pleiadians. There's,
right,
you know, lots and lots of beings that are part of this Galactic Federation. And so they asked for the Galactic Federations for assistance, you know, and so the Galactic Federation, well, we're peacekeepers, so yeah, you know, we're going to come and help you. So they established, one of their headquarters in the Mintaka planet or star system, which is part of the belt stars. And they were able to eventually, after many years, establish peace and unity in Orion. So now Orion has shifted to the light, you know, so Orion is, but these empire beings, the ones that didn't want to assimilate into the light, you know, they were like, you know, we don't want any part of this, you know, they left and looked for new places to conquer, you know, so it was like, you know what, you know, we're out of here. We don't want to be a part of this. We want to continue with our bad deeds and be bad. And so they ended up coming to our solar system, particularly at first, Maldek, which Maldek is a planet that used to be located between Mars and Jupiter, which got destroyed. And then it is now the asteroid belt. So everything has a...
And why was it destroyed? Was it destroyed naturally, destroyed by...
Oh, no, it was a big civil war. Because you had, for a while, the Orion Empire people were sending, like their undesirables to Maldek. And so you have a bunch of like really bad people hanging out on one planet. They're going to get, you know, they're going to have conflict, you know. So they ended up blowing themselves up, which now created the asteroid belt. So when that happened, quite a few of the negative Orion factions ended up infiltrating into Atlantis, you know. So Atlantis, initially when it was created, like a lot of people have mixed feelings about Atlantis because it was this amazing civilization, but yet they had some dark aspects.
Right.
Initially, you know, Atlantis was created to be the representation of Father God consciousness on planet Earth. And it was an amazing, you know, civilization. You know, they were very aligned spiritually. They had amazing technology. But then, you know, these factions came in and started overtaking the government, kind of infiltrating into the government, and started making some bad decisions. One of that being they decided to go to war with Lemuria, you know, which was on the Pacific. You know, so a lot of people have heard about Lemuria, which was the more the mother goddess consciousness representation. And a lot of us have had incarnations either in Atlantis or Lemuria or both. I even see people that have had incarnations in both of these civilizations. Now, Lemuria was pretty spiritually oriented, so they weren't really big on technology because they were all about the power of intention. They were just
right.
But so they didn't have the technology to withstand attacks from Atlantis, and so Lemuria fell. And that's when Earth went from the fifth dimension into the third dimension at that point. And we've been in the third dimension ever since. So these powers to be in Atlantis pretty much after Atlantis fell. So Atlantis, you know, there was a civil war also in Atlantis. I mean, these beings never seem to get along with each other, you know. So they create havoc wherever they go. So Atlantis fell, and they dispersed out into Europe and other parts of the planet, you know. And they've been in pretty much in control of the planet ever since. Now, before, you know, Atlantis and Lemuria happened, there were extraterrestrial beings that were visiting Earth millions of years ago, and were bringing their genetics or their DNA or DNA from their systems to planet Earth. So planet Earth is kind of a hodgepodge of DNA and genetics and materials from other star systems. So we're kind of unique in that sense. But it's a nice planet. You know, it's an awesome little planet. There's no other planet like it. You know, so of course the extraterrestrial beings have a great interest in this planet. Now, the powers to be that are the reptilian factions, the Anunnaki or whatever you want to call them, the Illuminati or whatever you want to call them, they're not wanting to let go of this planet. Okay, they like, you know, having, you know, control over something. They've been impeding the progress of this planet for thousands and thousands of years. Now, where we all got involved, you know, those of us that are light workers and starseeds, started after World War II. So I do believe that a lot of us were still incarnating on Earth. And of course, when you're in the higher realms, there is no linear time. So we might be having lifetimes in the past, what's considered to be Earth's past, simultaneous to this one, you know. But what happened was around the time of World War II, when Hiroshima was bombed, that got the attention of the Galactic Councils. And they were like, oh, no, we can't have Earth blowing itself up because that's what happened to Maldek. You know, there was a big call out for volunteers to come in and ensure that Earth is able to ascend appropriately to the fifth dimension. And so that's where a lot of us come in, you know, a lot of us that are, you know, truth tellers like yourself or, you know, or like me, you know, I'm just trying to remind people, you know, what happened and where we came from, you know, that no, we didn't come from Adam and Eve. You know, I think that's more of an analogy, you know, more than anything else. But it was almost like we're kind of replaying some of the events, you know, that have happened in the past, but it's giving us an opportunity to do things differently, you know. So this happens on a very personal level for a lot of us, but also on a very mass collective level, you know, where, hey, this is an opportunity for us to replay some of those old lessons or those old events that we went through or those old experiences, traumas, whatever you want to call them, and also, you know, be able to make different decisions, you know, see how, if I make a different decision, how it's going to play out, you know, and we can do this on a collective level as well. But
right.
To get back to the reptilians, since you had an interest in that, and I think a lot of people have interest in reptilians, they do have a caste system. So there are, and not all of them are bad. Okay. I see in the records quite a few reptilian beings, in, you know, particularly those that are associated with Sirius or those that are maybe dragon caste, you know, beings. The dragons are kind of neutral. You know, they kind of like do their own thing. They don't really want to get pulled into, you know, conflict. You know, they have, you know, they're kind of self-interest beings, but occasionally they will help. You know, occasionally there are some good dragons that will help humans. So we do see quite a few representations of that throughout human history and beyond. But there's also reptilian beings that have shifted to the light, you know, that are, you know, are great healers, you know, particularly those that are associated with Sirius. And some, they also summon Orion, because I get a lot of backlash on Instagram and social media because people hear a snippet of me saying something like, oh, well, not all reptilians are bad. And then they freak out, you know, it's like, yeah, they're not.
Well, how can anything whole be bad? But here's my question for you then.
Yeah.
When you say, so those dark forces or the reptilians are still in control, like still controlling things till this day.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean? Does that mean through a lineage of incarnation and people don't even realize where they're coming from, but they're operating with this DNA? Or is it more from beyond infiltrating and affecting?
I think it's both. I do think quite a few of the royal families and, you know, the one percenters, if you want to call it that, have genetics that are reptilian. Maybe they're not completely reptilian, but some of them are. But we won't go down that rabbit hole. But some of them are. But some of them might have some reptilian genetics. And my understanding is that there was 300 families within Europe that had signed treaties. These were prominent families, you know, families of, you know, that had high status, they signed treaties with the reptilians. Like, hey, you know, if you help our family, you know, we will devote, you know, our loyalty to your cause, you know, kind of thing. And what they get out of it is protection and money. And what the reptilians get out of it is control, you know. So, you know, so it kind of plays. So it's kind of like layers and layers of layers of control that occur. So a lot of these, I don't know if you've ever noticed, but a lot of our presidents here in the United States are related to each other or come from similar lineages. I think there's a reason for that. A lot of people that are in power, they tend to marry within their own groups, you know. There's a whole purpose for that. You know, this happened in Egypt, but still happens even today, maybe not to the extreme where they're marrying brother and sister, but, you know, they kind of want to keep that, you know, that reptilian connection within themselves, and they want to keep the control. To go into why, I don't know. It seems like, you know, they like being in power,
mm-hmm.
and they don't want to give up their power. You know, they like having, you know, 90% of all the money, you know, on the planet, and
right.
And being able to do what they want to do, you know, which is to stay in control. And they also want to reduce the population, you know, because right now I think we're at, what, 8 billion and on planet Earth, maybe a little more, but they want to reduce it to 500 million, you know, so they can have better control over, you know, the rest of us. So they're in this process of trying to take control, but they're losing. And I think they on some level, they realize that, but, you know, because they're also on the flip side, you know, extraterrestrial, benevolent extraterrestrial races that are trying to help, you know, us here on planet Earth, maybe more subversively. but they can't really interfere with our decisions or our free will. But if we ask for assistance, you know, they will come and assist us, you know, so that this will be like the Galactic Federation or the Galactic Councils, you know, the Andromeda Council, you know, those factions. So we're kind of undergoing kind of a conflict between light and dark at this time. Mm-hmm. And also on a maybe a lesser level, you know, a balancing of masculine and feminine energies here on planet Earth. Planet Earth has been pretty much very patriarchal. I mean, yeah. It started off being a very divine feminine, very, you know, feminine, you know, reality. But then when Lemuria fell, it became very patriarchal. And so there's a big imbalance of those energies. And so a lot of us as light workers and starseeds, we're here to try to bring that balance more towards the divine feminine, you know, maybe more of a balance between the two, because you can also go too far into the divine feminine.
Right.
You know, obviously we don't want to do that either, but.
And where are we on that shift? Yeah. Where are we on the shift? Where are we on the, you know, trying to reclaim back to going to 5D? Where are we as a whole?
I think we're on our way there. I think energetically the planet is changing and shifting. Maybe there's humans that are not integrated with that. I don't know if you've noticed, but a lot of people are dying lately.
Totally.
I mean, it's just like, if they're not aligned with that energy, they're going to get attritioned out, you know? And that's what's kind of happening right now. The Bible talks about, you know, the separation of the wheat from the shaft. And that's what they were talking about, was that either you're going to be part of the ascension process or you're going to get shifted out. And so there's a lot of, you're seeing people just dying everywhere. Yeah. You know, maybe the media is trying to hide it to a certain extent, but I do think on some level, you know, the COVID, you know, crisis and epidemic was a catalyst for that, you know.
Yeah.
You know, it was a catalyst for awakening, if you know, because, you know, people were still kind of in, you know, this bubble of, you know, oh, I'm here, you know, I'm just having this, you know, 3D reality kind of thing. It caused a lot of people to start questioning things. And so in a way, there was a silver lining to the epidemic. And that I've seen more people awaken in 2020 than even in 2012, which was another, you know, monumental year. So I do think we're on our way there. I don't know if you've noticed, but even in our environment, like the details just look very sharp, much sharper than they used to. Colors are more brilliant.
I was saying that yesterday.
Yeah, the sun seems brighter, you know, it is not like in the past where everything was kind of hazy and, you know, not that it was bad or anything, but it was just, you know, and that's what 3D reality is. It's kind of like it's a artificial reality, you know, when we start moving into the fourth and the fifth, that's when we're getting into more hyper reality where things are more brilliant, or, you know, you're starting to see auras around things. And so I do think we're on our way there, but, you know, the dark factions aren't going without a fight, you know, so they're pulling out all stops things seem really intense right now, you know, on the political and, you know, global scale right now, but my understanding from my guides and, you know, who are the Arcturian Collective, is that things are under control, not to worry, you know, that the light will prevail, you know, and things are going to look messy for a while. It's going to look like, you know, it's gone to hell in a handbasket, you know, but I do think we're moving towards the golden age, you know, of ascension, you know, where we're going with what they talked about for years as calling it the age of Aquarius or you know, the 5D reality. You know, we are moving towards that, but not all of us are choosing to be a part of it or want to be a part of it.
Have your guides talked at all about, I find the idea, I've been talking a lot about this these last few weeks, just this idea of truth, mm-hmm. and like what is truth and the distortion of what is it? And also this, I feel like people are very compelled to feel like they understand truth mm-hmm. without actually wanting to see any real truth. So mm-hmm. there's a lot of spreading of things, whether it be through social media or whatever, mm-hmm. with so much energy behind it. We know what happens when there's energy, mm-hmm. but a weird disconnect, I feel like, of anyone really wanting to open up and sit and seeing whole stories.
My understanding just from social media is I think people grasp onto a piece of the truth, but it's almost like they're not quite ready or don't want to see the entire truth, you know, that, you know, it's almost like they get comfort from a small part of it rather than, what's the bigger story behind all of this? And so that's where I think the consciousness shift has to occur, where, you know, where we have to be willing to see everything, whether it's, you know, good aspects of the truth or darker aspects of the truth. You know, it's all, you know, it's in the higher realms, it's all, you know, neutral, you know, at this point, but I don't know if that makes sense, but yeah, I do agree with you that there is a lot of misinformation out there. And not to say that, you know, I got all the all the answers, or I know everything that's going on. You know, no one does. I think a lot of us right now are coming together and we're bringing pieces of information that we've picked up and trying to put the puzzle pieces together, which is amazing. I think that's an amazing process. So it opens us up for conversations and expansion of information, but it just seems like we're still a ways away from the place where we can say, oh, yes, we've made some headway. You know, I think we still got a lot of work to do.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. But yeah. I do love that you're saying that your guides were saying it's exactly how it should be.
I think it's I do have hope, you know, for this planet. I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing if I didn't think that we have a really high percentage of probability that things are going to shift for the better. And I do think that's happening behind the scenes. But right now it's almost like they have to take down all the old systems. And that's where, you know, I think a lot of us are trying to do that. We're changing systems. You know, we're not going with the status quo anymore. You know, we're refusing to.
So you mentioned that your guides are from the Arcturian Council. Mm-hmm. So when you go into your Akashic Records, is that where you see your lineage, or is it just the guides for you?
My understanding when I had my extraterrestrial contact experience, which, you know, you haven't asked about that yet, but, you know, it was a big part of why I got into doing this.
We're about to get there.
Yeah, we're about to get there. But, is that my lineage is from Arcturus, you know, that was my origination point, if you want to call it, as a soul or, so I am an Arcturian soul that's you know, incarnated in human form, you know, but, you know, just playing out this, you know, trying to help, you know, with the ascension process. So a lot of my guides are Arcturian. I do have some Pleiadian guides, and I have, you know, guides from other systems as well, and angelic guides. A lot of us have a mix of guides. I think people get real kind of narrow-minded about, I only have like guides from here or a specific guide. And it's like, we have a lot of guides. I mean, usually about 20 to 25, but even more than that, a lot of times, you know, we can call on quite a few guides, and not always the same ones, you know, so sometimes we might be able to say, you know what, I need help from my Syrian guides because I'm dealing with a physical health issue. You know, Syrians were the masters of physical health. Or I need to call, I need help with, developing my spirituality. So maybe I might call upon, you know, my Arcturian guides, or a lot of people have Arcturian guides that maybe don't have an Arcturian lineage. the Arcturians will be guides to anybody. You know, they're part of this whole ascension process. They want to see us succeed. So they're kind of like the universal guides almost, but like
love
angels.
That.
Yeah.
So let's talk about it. So you were living a very normal life. So tell us a little bit, where were you at and how all of a sudden your life changed?
I was a very 3D person. Okay. I had 3D problems. I was one of these people that just struggled through life. I mean, I was, I don't know. It was just, you know, I was trying to fit into a system I didn't understand, you know, incarnating here as a starseed. I had questions about everything. You know, it's just like, even from as a child, like, what's
like
this?
What?
Religion. That was a big one. Yeah, religion. What the heck is this religion thing? You know, yeah. you know, and I was brought up Roman Catholic, so that was even worse. Okay.
Yeah.
And I was just trying to fit in. I come from a military family. Maybe I chose that, you know, but I ended up joining the military myself and served in the Navy for 6 years. Sometimes people ask what I was doing in the Navy. I was a hospital corpsman, so I worked in the medical side of things. And then I ended up, ending my enlistment in the Navy. I wasn't an officer. I was just an enlisted person. And then went into the environmental health field and worked in that field for 30 years, you know, on and off. I took on some jobs in the IT field for a while. So I come from a very technical background. And I never really subscribed to the paranormal. I mean, I had some minor interest in spirituality, but I never really believed in the paranormal, believed in ghosts or aliens or UFOs until I met my now husband. He was the one that introduced me to all of this. And if you meet my husband, he's like a straight looking dude. You know, I was like, I mean, I was shocked, you know, when I was seeing some of the stuff he was reading, because I was like, what the heck, you know, what's... You know, because he was reading UFO magazines and I don't know what the heck. Yeah, he was like deep into it. And so I think just from exposure to some of the things he was interested in, it expanded my consciousness to, hey, you know, I'm still skeptical about it, but maybe there's some possibility here. Maybe this was like a little seed growing in my brain or something. But I never imagined that I would ever have this kind of experience that I was reading about, you know, because I was just like, you know, well, you know, I'm nobody special, you know, I'm just an ordinary person. So when this all occurred for me, I was in the process of moving. I used to live in Colorado Springs. That's actually my hometown. And my husband and I decided to move forward in our relationship. So we decided to reside together in Castle Rock, which we're still at. And during this time, this was in 2012, there was a lot of things going on the planet. There was just a lot of stuff happening, a lot of stuff happening personally, a lot of stuff happening on the planet. And so I started worrying a lot. I always kind of joke that I'm a spiritual worrier, not a spiritual warrior, but... I worry a lot, but I used to anyway. I don't so much anymore. But so I was worried about the state of the planet. And so I sent out this prayer to the universe one night. I was really scared about what was going on. And, you know, people
specifically
were talking about,
what for you at that time?
The Mayan, you know, the end of the Mayan cycle. Mm-hmm. Everybody was talking about that.
Yep.
I mean, not that I think the world was going to end, but I just didn't know what that meant. And then, you know, we were going through a big election process during that time. You know, there was a lot of changes geopolitically that was happening, a lot of degradation of the economic system, you know, so there was just a lot going on, you know, and so I was, you know, I think just as a, you know, a semi-concerned person, you know, I was just like, you know, what the heck is going on, you know, but we need some help, you know, so I sent out this prayer to the higher realm, you know, the angels, you know, Jesus, Mother Mary, you know, God, whoever would listen, you know. And then at the last minute, I decided to include the Galactic Brothers and Sisters. I don't know where that came from, but I just, you know, I'm just sending it out there. You know, we just need help. And so I had this prayer, and then the next day, you know, things went back to normal, no big deal. Went, you know, forgot about the prayer. About 2 weeks after I said that prayer, I went to sleep as normal, and when I came to consciousness, I was in a different reality, and it wasn't a dream. I mean, it was way too real to be a dream. It was almost like an out-of-body experience, maybe similar to what somebody that goes through, like an NDE goes through, you mm-hmm. know, that near-death experience. But I was definitely on some sort of a extraterrestrial craft. And how I knew this was because it didn't look like anything I've ever seen, you know.
What did it look like?
It was very organic. I mean, it was very futuristic, you know, like you would imagine, but it wasn't metallic. It didn't look like it was constructed physically. It looked more like a light, like it was constructed of light and some sort of materials, like maybe plasma or very kind of fluid. But it was very beautiful, a lot of bright lights, a lot of colors. And, you know, I was just, you know, overwhelmed, you know, just like, wow, I've never seen this kind of thing. And it had some structure to the sense that, you know, it had like hallways and rooms, you know, so it had, you know, some sort of a structure. But so, and the ship itself was huge. It was like city size. Of course, I didn't realize that until later in this experience, but it was guiding me towards the space. And so I was less like, okay, for some reason it wants me to go here. So I went into this space, this room, and there was about four or five extraterrestrial beings waiting for me there. And I've never seen beings that looked like this. They looked sort of like, if you were just to glance at them, you would think, oh, maybe they're gray aliens, but they weren't. I mean, they were, they had larger heads, larger eyes, but their skin tone wasn't gray. It was more like a greenish blue. And they were, they had more refined features than gray aliens do. And their eyes had pupil and irises, and they had very kindly expressions. They just emit a lot of this love energy, just feel really good when you're around them. So I didn't even have a chance to be scared because I was just like, wow, what are these beings? But I knew they weren't from Earth, you know?
Right.
You know, so I was asking these beings, you know, so I was trying to formulate in my head, like, do they understand English? How do I ask them a question? You know? And then even before I would ask the question, they were finished my question in my head, they were answering my questions telepathically. So they were connecting with me telepathically, and obviously they understood English quite well. So no problems there. So they ended up, so I basically just asked them, you know, where am I? What is this? Who are you? You know, why am I here? And they told me they were Arcturians from the star system of Arcturus, that's located in the Bodhis constellation. And while they were explaining this to me, they had me in some sort of a holographic sphere, which was illustrating some of the concepts, you know, and this was amazing technology because you felt like you were there.
Wow.
Like if they were showing you the cosmos, you felt like you were in the cosmos. I mean, it was, or they were showing you some part of planet Earth, you felt like you were there. It was pretty freaking amazing. I was just like overwhelmed, you know, with all these, you know, sensations, you know. So they were illustrating some of their concepts, you know, I would say telepathically, but also through this holographic sphere. And then they told me that, I was there asking them question after question, because I just want to know what the heck was going on, you know.
Right.
What's going on with planet Earth? It's a shit show down there, you know? So they were answering quite a few of my questions, and they were very patient. they had a sense of humor. Sometimes they'd crack a joke here and there, and it was kind of cute, you know, very kind of, but they were very kindly beings. I didn't feel afraid with them at all. And I asked, why me? You know, I'm nobody special. You know, I'm just this, I'm, you know, I was working at the health department at the time as a health inspector. You know, I was nobody, you know, that had any influence anywhere. But they told me the reason why was partially because of my prayer. They felt like at that point I was ready, you know, I was ready for my mission, and that I came from a long lineage of Arcturian beings that, you know, were, I think they mentioned, were doctors, scientists, and ambassadors, you know, historians, you know. So I'm like, okay, that's cool. You know, I was like, what the heck, you know, but because I always thought it was human, you know, but, and then they explained, you know, that a lot of what's happening on Earth is just part of this, not a social experiment. I kind of hate that terminology, right. But it's an illusion, you know, it's part of this 3D illusionary matrix that we all chose to be, play this role in. Not that Earth isn't, you know, doesn't have some struggles to go through, but I had chosen as a soul to play a mission or have a mission in this incarnation. And it was their job to remind me of my mission, you know? So
what was your mission?
I didn't know at the time.
They didn't tell you what the mission was. They just said there is a mission.
They just said it was a mission. And then, and I didn't find out what my mission was until, I think it was like, almost like they wanted me to go through this evolution, you know? Until you're not ready to hear it yet, you know, but we'll tell you later. And that's a whole other story of how I found out what my mission was. But I mean, it was so much information coming in. You know, they told me that a lot of religion is just man-made construct. It's not, you know, it's not a part of our real connection with God or with Source. And that was a mind blowing for me because I was raised Roman Catholic.
So, yeah.
You know? Yeah. You know, so I didn't know, you know, like why, because I asked them, what religion are you? And they said, we don't have a religion. We have a direct connection with Source.
Right.
So they kind of explained a lot of things to me. So it was almost like I went from being very asleep to very, very awake, you know, just in one night, you know.
How did you leave?
That was interesting too. So they showed me around the ship. They let me loose and let me wander by myself at some point. And I ended up in this atrium at the center of the ship. It was just huge. It was like, I don't know, several stories high. It was just amazing. And there was hundreds of extraterrestrial beings there. I mean, there was beings, I mean, the majority of them looked humanoid, but there were some that weren't. But the ones that I saw were mostly humanoid looking, but you could tell they weren't from Earth, you know, that there was something a little different about them. So there was these light shafts that would transport these beings to different parts of this atrium because it was so big. And I tried to get on one of these light shafts because it looked kind of cool. It had rainbows. It was like, you know, wow, you know, it's like my unicorn dreams come true, you know? So,
yeah,
you know, so I wanted to get on one and it kept throwing me off. And so there was a Pleiadian being that caught me when I was thrown off and telepathically told me that I wasn't doing it correctly, that I had to set an intention on where I wanted to go before it would allow me on, you know, the shaft, you know. So, and it was comprised of light. It was just light. I mean, there was no structure to it. So I said, okay, you know what you're doing. I'm going to do it your way. And so I chose a spot and got on, and it was transporting me across this huge space. And then the next thing I knew, I was awake and in my bed.
Wow.
You know, I was a little bummed because I wanted to see what the other side was.
Of course.
Yeah. But
so wait, did And then how many did they ever come back and bring you back there?
One time. So this happened in May 2012, the end of May. In December 2012, I had a second visit on board the same ship. It was with the Pleiadian being that helped me with the light shaft. It was a masculine looking being, a male, and he was there with a Pleiadian looking female. So this time I didn't interact with the Arcturians. I interacted with these Pleiadian beings. And they were giving me at the time more information about, you know, my, you know, just family members, my cat, who was apparently she was an amazing cat. She was, she was a registered therapy animal. And her soul, I guess, originated from the Pleiades. So they were telling me her story and how I ended up working with her, how she ended up with me. But she's no longer with us, unfortunately. She served the Denver and Colorado Springs communities as a therapy animal for 6 years and did amazing work. I mean,
wow.
She, one of only four cats that was registered.
I love that.
In the state of Colorado.
So how did you find out what your mission was? So, two things. So your husband's the one who's totally into this stuff. So when you wake up and you're like, oh my God, let me tell you what happened to me. Was he like, why you?
Yeah, he was a little, I think, taken back at first. And at first he didn't believe me. He thought it was a crazy dream. Or, you know, I said, no, it wasn't a dream. It was too real. I mean, because I've had lucid dreams, but it wasn't like a lucid dream. And I think he was a little upset at first because, not in a bad way, but just kind of like, why
naturally.
You know, I've been following this stuff all my life and you get to have this experience, you know. But I don't think he was, you know, begrudging about it or anything. I think he was just kind of shocked at first. But, you know, now, you know, there's been, you know, I think 12 years, you know, 14 years, you know, I don't know, 12 years since then. But no, I think it's been 14 years since that happened. Time just flies. But now I think he's accepted it. He's accepted that, you know, hey, something happened to me. And because it completely transformed my life, you know,
right.
I mean, I was not the same person the next
after
day.
That.
Yeah. But getting back to your original question, what was it again?
How did you figure out your mission?
So I started taking a lot of spiritual classes, you know, so this was, I think this was part of my evolution that the Arcturians wanted me to go through, you know, so they didn't want to just hand me the answers, you know, so, you know, I had to work for them, I guess. But, so I took every spiritual class I could possibly get my hands on, you know, mostly locally, you know, in person, but I also did quite a few online courses, but I was just trying to figure out, you know, what is going on? Because I was getting massive downloads of information about galactic wars, galactic history.
Oh, wow.
About different star systems, different star races. And I was like, where is this stuff coming from? Am I going crazy? You know, so I started doing a lot of research. So I had this vision. So I was meditating one day and I had this vision that I was supposed to go to Crestone, Colorado, which is on the southwestern part of Colorado, south central. And it's an area that has a lot of extraterrestrial activity. There is actually a UFO watchtower there. I mean, it's a kind of cool place. And it's a very spiritual location. So there's a lot of ashrams and Buddhist centers and stuff there. And so they told me I was supposed to go there and fly a kite. And I was like, what the heck?
Very specific.
Yeah, very specific. Okay. I'm like, okay. So it just so happened that the very next week, I got invited to go to a spiritual retreat with a friend of mine who was teaching the retreat. And I was just there as a participant. And I thought, great, I can fly my kite, you know. So I bought a kite and I was there and I flew it. And then I got massive downloads, and they told me the reason why they wanted me to fly this kite was because there was energies there that were coming from this Arcturian portal that was in the San Luis Mountains. You know, that Crestone is a small, really small rinky-dink town in the middle of the San Luis Mountains. And at that time, they told me what my mission was, you know, that I was supposed to remind people of where we came from and who we truly are. You know, who we are as a race of beings, you know, that we're not just ordinary Earth humans, you know, that our genetics came from a lot of different places, that, you know, we've had, you know, incarnations beyond Earth, you know, so, and that I was supposed to be of assistance to the starseeds that are here, you know, that was the other part of my mission, you know, so I was like, okay. So I went, you know, finished up the retreat. And soon after that, I had the opportunity to take some classes on how to read the Akashic Records.
Ooh.
I was always, I think,
curious.
Connected to the records, but I didn't understand what was happening. You know, so I just get these downloads and I was like, you know, what the heck's going on? You know, but I think I was always connecting with them. But this gave me, you know, the actual process on how to do it. So I took all three levels and became an Akashic reader at this point. So I started doing this in 2014, I'll say, or the latter part of 2014. And then in 2016 was when I was asked to share my extraterrestrial contact experience in the metro area of Denver. You know, so some of the groups were asking me to talk about my experience, which kind of led me to what I'm doing now. As far as my abilities, I never had these abilities before my extraterrestrial contact experiences. Pretty much normal, basic human, okay? But after I had the first extraterrestrial contact experience, I noticed I was seeing UFOs all the time. And that my extrasensory perception increased tremendously, you know, where I was starting to see auras around things. I was downloading information about different people, different events. And I didn't know where this information, and including the big galactic downloads, you know, that I was getting.
Right.
You know, so something had changed, you know, but.
Do you think there was a download they gave you when you were there? Or do you think it's in the energetic shift of having to go to that place and then come back?
That's an interesting question. No one's ever asked me that before. I think it might have been something got activated when I was there. But I also think I was at the point where my consciousness had expanded enough, even before the experience, where I could accept what was or understand what was happening to a certain level.
Right.
You know? So I think maybe the answer is both. Yeah. I don't know. You know, because before that, you know, I was part of, you know, the animal assisted therapy team with my cat Piglet, who was actually a small,
that's a great name.
She's an adorable little hairless Sphinx cat. You know, everybody just fell in love with her. She just emitted this love energy. She was just like pure love, you know. She was a perfect therapy animal, very calm.
Right.
She's one of those cats that you could take her anywhere. You know, she was very, I don't know, it was like she had an understanding of things beyond like an average cat.
Clearly,
You know, so... And I noticed that about her right away. She was a rescue, you know, so I adopted her, and I know there's something different about this cat, you know. I mean, so I was watching the show on Animal Planet, you know, channel, and they were talking about therapy animals. I said, oh my God, I think Piglet could do that, you know. So she and I went through the training. They actually had training in, at the time, with the American Humane Association, not to be confused with the Humane Society. They're two different organizations.
Yeah.
But we got certified, and for 6 years we volunteered all of our free time. We were visiting libraries, hospitals, nursing homes. I mean, we did so much in 6 years. I mean, myself and Piglet. Mm. You know? But I kind of consider her to be my teacher. She was preparing me for my, you know, eventual being of service, you know, like she was teaching me how to be of service to others, which was, so there was, you know, there's been avatars, you know, throughout my life that kind of led me to this point, but yeah, I would say the main event was obviously the extraterrestrial contact experience.
I mean, I love the flying the kite. That's so incredible.
Yeah, that was pretty bizarre. I have to admit, I was just like,
it's like a very specific way to connect that they're like, fly a kite.
I know.
Flying a kite's not always easy, by the way. So that's
no,
so interesting.
No, it's not. No, I mean, I haven't been able to connect like that since, but it was, now I think, you know, as far as we, me and my guides, we have pretty much a symbiotic relationship where I'm always connected with my guides. You know, a lot of people think, how do I connect with my guides? And it's so easy. You know, it's like, you just connect with them. You talk with them, you know, but I think you also have to be willing to let things in, you know, even if it's doesn't look like what you're expecting. I think sometimes people have this expectation, and a lot of times the reality of the connection is not quite the same as the expectation, you know? So,
like give an example.
Like a lot of people think that the guides are just going to show up in your living room or you're going to see these beautiful beings, you know, that are, just going to hand you like, I don't know, something, you know?
Right.
And a lot of times what happens, it's more of a feeling or more of an energetic connection. And
right.
You might hear things telepathically, and you might get some images, but it's not as dramatic or grandiose as I think people are wanting it to be, but it's actually in a way better because it makes it more real. I don't know if that makes sense.
Well, yeah, no, it's a good thing to tell people too, because I wouldn't be surprised if some people miss it because they're looking for something bigger when they're probably receiving more than they realize.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And this is a lot of questions. I get a lot of questions about guides from my clients, you know, that are, you know, wanting to connect with their guides. And I said, don't overthink it. You know, meditation does help a lot, though. I mean,
right.
You know, having a regular meditation practice does open up those channels. And so, so I don't want to downgrade meditation because it's pretty much a key component to connecting with guides.
What does your practice look like?
Usually I get up in the morning, even before my husband gets up, and I have my coffee. I'm a big coffee drinker. I don't know. I'm just one of my little human, I guess, attachments.
You are human.
yeah, attachments. But and a lot of times I'll just sit down either in my my office or I'm in my office currently, or in the sunroom if it's warm enough. And then I just sit. And I did learn meditation through the Zen Buddhist Center. So they have a whole process. I don't really go through that whole process. I think it was just
that was
interesting. Yeah, it was just interesting to learn their technique. But I just sit with myself and I just clear my head. And I just let whatever's supposed to come through come through. Sometimes I do get visions. Sometimes I'll get an answer to something that, you know, maybe I've been struggling with. Or for instance, just to give you an example of that, recently I had a realization that I tend to be kind of OCD and an anxious person by nature. And that the OCD and you know, my focus, sometimes I look at things very critically, was kind of a shield from, you know, that was keeping me from feeling things. And, cause I don't like to feel things. I don't know. It's not very intensive, you know? Maybe some not so pleasant emotions, but also even sometimes the good emotions. Like I like
too
to
much.
Be on this kind of, you know, central plane. So when things get a little too extreme, I feel really uncomfortable. And that comes from my trauma and this life, you know. So it was a really profound insight I had, which is maybe not so extraterrestrial or grandiose, but it was just kind of a personal insight to, wow, you know, that is something I do a lot. You know, I tend to be kind of perfectionistic and critical because it shields me from having to really feel things, you know. And these are realizations that we can also get from the Akashic records, you know. So a lot of times, if I'm doing what I call an Akashic clearing with a client, these are the types of things that usually comes up, you know, like, why are you falling into these old patterns? You know, what are you supposed to learn from this? You know, which we can have a whole other session probably about, or a whole other podcast about Akashic clearings. That'll be probably a good
one. Happy to do it. I love that idea.
Yeah, Akashic clearings. Yeah, that's a whole other realm of possibilities. But
how amazing for you, like, to get this mission of remind people where they're from. And you've done it in so many ways. You've done it, you know, for the collective, like where you tell this history, which you were so lovely to give us a little story time. And then also individually, when you had sessions with people, really bringing them back to their source and who they are. And I'm sure you've shifted so many people finally being like, this is what I need to do. We're actually just feeling whole.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I've enjoyed the time I've had doing the one-on-one readings. I'm not currently doing one-on-one readings. My guides have showed me, that my mission is now educating the masses. So I have to take the message broader. So that's part of the reason why I'm not doing readings anymore. And plus, I was doing them for 12 years, and you know, after a while, energetically, it's a drain, you know, so I just need a break, you know. So I'm focused on writing a book and focused on so hopefully I'll have a book to offer maybe this time next year. So
that's exciting. Well, then you'll have to come back on when we have the book for sure. That's very exciting. And then how do you miss doing the one-on-ones, or no, you were burnt out?
A little bit. I think the connection with people I miss, because I had some beautiful clients. I mean, amazing, amazing, you know, clients. But in a way, I don't miss it, because I feel like my purpose now is to help people to develop these skills for themselves, not to rely on me or other leaders, you know. So
fantastic.
So that's why I'm teaching an Akashic, Galactic Akashic reading course in April. That, if you're interested in knowing how to do what I do, you know, or my process, please join us. You know, we'd love to have you, you know, so,
Well, I love that. And thank you for all of this. Let's definitely have you back on to talk about Akashic clearing. Good luck writing your book this year. It feels like a great year for that.
Yeah.
And, totally. And thank you so much for all of the insight and just giving people kind of this idea of this crazy story. I mean, it's so big. And you
so crazy that you can't make it up, you know,
you can't make it up. And you do a really good job of, you know, bringing it down to nuggets, because it's hard to digest. So thank you.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you for having me on. It's been very, I just feel like we have this great connection, and I'm very happy to
agree
to be a part of this. Yeah,
I agree. Well, we'll continue chatting for sure.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.